Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, the best in new inventory. Great pre-owned inventory with the Sunbury Motors Guarantee. And a fabulous service department that makes it all work for the life of the vehicle. It's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. All right. Time now for our play-by-play call of the day.
Would have been a good idea if I would have gotten one of those, you know what?
Glad to see you're in mid-season form.
You know, I'm sitting there, as we're going through the news, I'm like, geez, there's something we used to do right out of the news. What was that thing that we used to do right? Oh, it's something we still do right out of the news.
Yeah.
I'll see what I can come up with.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go. All right.
Aren't you so glad you're working with such a professional?
I miss Matt.
I don't blame you. I don't blame you one bit.
That's how I always kid around. I said, are the jokes really this easy? All right. Well, under the category of nobody in the PAC-12 knows what's going on. Like, evidently, the PAC-12 is discussing today among its presidents and chancellors what's going on with the media deal.
Wouldn't it be a good idea to have a PAC-12 before you worry about the media deal?
Yeah, I mean, this is the only way to keep it together. If they don't have one or one that's going to give them enough juice, you can't have a PAC-12. They then all become free agents as of August 1st next year. And that is a big problem. Without question. I mean, the way I understand it is, one, if ESPN were to be involved, they only want one game a week, and they want it in the 10:30 Eastern time slot. Okay. Number two, Amazon. They would like one game a week, but they want it in the Friday 10:30 time slot. That's a little thin. That's a little thin. And the problem that they have is that a lot of this depends on streaming. See, now we're up your alley. Right? You're into the streaming part of it.
Well, I guess what I don't... Now, doesn't ABC already own the PAC-12 network?
No.
Or is that a Fox? Is that Fox that owns that?
Fox owns BTN.
Right.
As Fox has 68% of BTN. The ESPN has the SEC network and the ACC network. There is no Big 12 network. The PAC-12 networks are run by the PAC-12.
Really?
Yes, and it's a disaster, by the way.
I've watched it. Yeah.
I mean, but the production is not a disaster. The production is professional and the whole deal. There's nothing wrong with the production.
No, I mean the shows that are in between the games.
It's the clearances. It's the clearances. Like, how do you get it? Where do you get it? The Big 12's deal with Fox and ESPN will end up being about $31.7 million per campus. Okay? Now, that's... Again, that's not the Big Ten's deal or the SEC's deal. There is a chasm between the Big Ten, SEC, and everybody else. Right now, the Big 12, which jumped over the PAC-12 and did their deal first, even though their deal was up after the PAC-12. Okay? But they got to deal with Fox and ESPN. So... The PAC-12 Board of Directors are having their latest meeting today. The next one is not scheduled until the first week of April. All right? They claim that resolution is close. So Michael Crow is the Arizona State president. He told the state press that the conference had reached the, quote, final stages of the process. And Arizona's Robert Robbins told the hotline, and he also told this to other media outlets, that the deal was, quote, close. Both expressed confidence in George Kliavkov would present an acceptable proposal. Okay. Now, let's give the PAC-12, outside of how they handled the UCLA deal, how they handled that, I thought was embarrassing. It really was. They did a lot of talking, a lot of posturing, and blah, 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 blah. But since the UCLA thing was settled by the California Board of Regents, all right, since that has been settled, I do admire the discipline with which the PAC-12 has handled its messaging. They have really, all of them have at least talked unity. They've been on point. There's no red meat that's been thrown out there. There's been, you know, no discord that's been thrown out there, no dissatisfaction that's been quietly whispered, anything like that. Nope. None of their people have done that, from coaches to presidents to chancellors. None of them have. Right? Again, how they handled USC and UCLA, especially the UCLA part, okay, they handled it all wrong. But since that got resolved in the second week of December, the PAC-12 has been, at least externally, on point with their messaging. There also has been, I mean, they just went through the PAC-12 tournament 2 weeks ago. It would have been, 2 weeks today? Would have been the day before the start of their tournament. And George Kliavkov, he's there, said nothing about progress, anything. I mean, no interviews, nothing. And the feeling is that the commissioner has gone deep into the process, so he has at least an idea what the numbers are, whether it's ESPN or Amazon or Apple. And they seem to feel that the Arizona president would not have gone public if the situation behind the scenes was in dire straits. Now, this doesn't mean they're out of the woods yet, because they're not. They're far from it. Because until there's some concrete deal that's on the table where they can vote up or down, they've got, you know, they still have trouble. I know that there's talk about expansion. that maybe the door might be open to San Diego State. Maybe the door might be open to SMU, which gives them more inventory to put out there for these companies to broadcast. And it's not only getting a TV deal, it's whether they, you know, the TV deal also then goes with it. If you sign on to it, the grant of rights goes with it. I would think that if, and it's still a big if they get a TV deal, I think it's going to be 5 years. Just a guess, but I think it's going to be 5 years because the deal would not start until the 2024 season. So that would take you, what, to 24, 25, 6, 7, 8, 29. That means your deal would finish before the Big Ten negotiates again. That's why I think it'll be 5. Now, whether they're getting the numbers they want, because, I mean, OutKick reported that the PAC-12 is not close to a deal. Okay? And Andrew Marchand, who's always on top of this, he's one of the best in the business, John Griffin. Oh, good for John. I'm glad for John. John Griffin got the Bucknell job. All right. John's a hell of a coach.
Just announced.
I'm a big John Griffin guy. Big John Griffin guy. Good for him. Well, that's a big plus for the program. Good for, you know, I'll tell you right now, I think that yeah, that is great.
Part of the deal was a weekly appearance on the Steve Jones Show, and that sealed it right there.
No, I'm sure it did. Yeah. But yeah, I mean, his son John played at Bucknell, right?
This is so fresh, I'm still catching up.
I think his son played at Bucknell, if I recall. And then his son Matt, played at Ryder in BC. And Matt at one point was the head coach at Roman Catholic down in Philly. But John did it. You know what? I'm happy for him. I think John is a really good coach. I thought he did a good job at Siena. I thought he was in a tough spot for a period of time at St. Joe's. But he's a good coach. And he will do a good job.
Yeah. Played 4 years at Bucknell, 1,084 points.
Mm-hmm. No, I think this is great for it's great for Bucknell, it's great for him. I'm happy for John. So there you go. That is great. And I'm very, very happy for Bucknell, and I'm happy for John. Now, that's an excellent hire. Excellent hire. Very, very nice. So, he will do a good job. Good for John Griffin. Happy about that. That's good. So, there you go. Good for John. Good, 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 good. All right. So congrats to Jen. You'll do a good job there. Do a good job. All right. We will take a break. We'll come back with more in a moment. Great to have you with us today as we continue on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I...
Ray Bucknell! Ray Bucknell! Ray for the art in the blue!
Well, they're bringing home one of their own. Huh? John Griffin? Coming back? He was on those teams that beat, what, Kansas and Arkansas, if I recall correctly, in the NCAA tournament. Yeah, he came off the bench on those teams. And that's great. You know, great pedigree. His dad was a terrific coach. And you look at, John's worked his way through this thing to get to this point. And he understands the culture. He understands the community. All of that. Now, he graduated with a degree in economics from Bucknell. Pretty good. But he still wants to coach.
I guess the economics worked out.
Exactly right. But, I mean, he's got just terrific pedigree. I mean, in terms of how he's worked his way to get to this point. At one point he was an associate head coach, I mentioned, at St. Joe's. He's worked with Billy Lang. Right? He did some work with the Indiana Pacers at one point. But I think he is a terrific addition. I mean, the last 4 years he's been the associate head coach at St. Joe's. And he knows the community. He knows the culture. He knows what it takes in the Patriot League. He knows all of that. And I think that this is an excellent hire. And let's face it. You're talking about a young guy. He's only in his 30s. And the bottom line is, I mean, he's going to bring a passion, all right, and an energy that is going to be critical to what Bucknell wants to do. And whenever you are an alumnus, you're not out there selling Bucknell. You are out there sharing Bucknell, and that's what John's going to do. When you are an alumnus, you share what your experience was like. And he can share about being NCAA tournament. I think, weren't they 9 seed or something like that in the NCAAs?
Yeah, I'd have to look it up. I can't remember that. But
but they beat Arkansas. They beat Kansas in the NCAAs. He was a part of that. So he knows what Bucknell can be. And I think this is terrific for him, but I think it's terrific for Bucknell. I think it's a great hire. I think it's an inspired hire. He'll do a great job.
They officially announce him tomorrow at 4:30, and then they have a nice little reception that's planned later in the or about an hour or so after that.
So all of you will be going to that, obviously, because there are free beverages.
I was going to say, is there food involved? I might be there then. No,
there's free beverages and snacks. For goodness sakes, well, you're all going to be there. It's leeching time. I got it. Hey. His first name's John, right? Yeah. Okay. Hey, John.
Hey. What's his name again? Oh,
I can see you guys right now. His dad was a terrific coach. John was a terrific player. And I think it's great. Can't say enough good things about him. Yeah, look, he's worked hard to get himself to this point. He gets to come home. It's Once again, you have the ability to have somebody on that bench that now has a depth of coaching experience. Right now, yeah, you got to move one chair over. Moving that one chair over brings with it a world of responsibility. There's no question about that. But it's his time, and he knows Bucknell, and the fans know him. He was a beloved player there. I mean, he was a key reserve in those two NCAA tournament teams. You're talking about a guy. I think John was a 1,000-point scorer.
Yeah, 1,089, I believe.
So you didn't think I knew anything about the guy?
Listen, even I knew this guy.
And he still came back.
Might have taken a little bit more arm twisting.
I mean, when the first question he asked Truex is, the suit's still not there, is he?
And he goes, well, he doesn't have to be.
Well, maybe at one point we get John on the show. Be great.
I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. While Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
CBS News Brief. Thousands of frustrated school staff members are striking in Los Angeles. Union leader Max Arias.
Enough is enough.
That's right.
If LAUSD truly values and is serious about reaching an agreement, they must show workers the respect they deserve.
CBS's Graham Cade says more protesters are showing up in New York ahead of former President Trump's possible indictment.
There's a huge security apparatus here, but in terms of protesters, there's maybe a dozen or two protesters in support of Trump, maybe a few more against Trump, but it's really not that big of a show of protest just yet.
And Treasury Secretary Janet Yellen spoke at the American Bankers Association summit today following the collapse of two major U.S. banks.
Similar actions could be warranted if smaller institutions suffered deposit runs that posed the risk of contagion.
CBS News Brief. I'm Monica Ricks.
Hey, Clark, I'm heading to Ultimate Express Car Wash. You want to go? What's with the big springs on your feet? I mean, where do you get those and why?
I found them on the intranet. I have to get used to them if I'm going to hop around the neighborhood delivering candy and eggs to the kids.
Oh, no. I guess that means a Peter Rabbit costume?
Sure does. Sometimes picking it up after she goes to Ultimate Express Car Wash. Gotta look the part.
This I have to see.
Clark, here's that rabbit costume you ordered. And I found these Easter egg magnets in the mailbox. Tell me you're not going to stick them all over the hybrid.
Clark, I have to say I agree with Sun down
it's
here.
Sunshine!
Those magnets will not look good on that car.
All right, I'll figure something else out. Let me bounce over here and get the suit. Wait a minute, I'm heading the wrong way. Wait, where are the brakes on these things?
I'll go get the Band-Aid.
Shine up your vehicle anytime you want with unlimited wash plans from Ultimate Express Car Wash in Sealands Grove, Danville, and Williamsport. They start at just $19.95 a month, and you can use your unlimited plan at any of the three locations to get clean, shiny, fast. Online at washmydirtycar.com.
You're on the spot reporter here at Sleep World with Jim, Jell, and the guys. Hey, guys, I need to know more about these new personal comfort number beds.
So, Scott, let me ask you a question. Do you like the exact same feel in a mattress you liked 10 years ago?
You know, it's funny that you ask. I know noticed that I do like a little softer bed now. But, you know, it's hard to find the exact right mattress at a store when you lay on it for only about 10 minutes.
I mean, this is a big reason why the personal comfort bed is so popular. You customize the feel of the bed to the firmness that you need.
So our bodies change from year to year. And Scott, you've told me that you like a softer bed than you did 10 years ago. Now, with a push of a button, you can change your setting to the exact comfort level you need.
So you don't have to buy a bed every few years. The bed changes as you change. It literally will save you thousands over your lifetime.
I have to say, guys, it's really the perfect way to go. We invite everyone to come on down to Sleep World and test out the new personal comfort number bed on the Strip in Sealers Grove next to Lowe's.
It's March, and you know what that means? Taxes are almost due. Jackson Hewitt can help you win tax season. That's the sound of your maximum tax refund. The sound of getting 50% off tax prep. The sound of many of our competitors' prices going up. And the sound of getting to your nearest Jackson Hewitt. Hurry in for 50% off tax prep before this offer expires April 9th. Limited time offer for new clients filing in participating locations. Max value $200. Visit jacksonhewitt.com/50 for terms.
Everyone loves TV Dad.
On the next TV Dad, presented by Progressive, TV Dad explains becoming a man.
Son, it's time we had the talk.
Okay, TV Dad.
You know, drivers who switch and save with Progressive could save hundreds.
Oh, is that why my voice is changing?
That's a question for your health teacher.
Listen to your TV Dad. Drivers who switch and save with Progressive could save hundreds. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. Potential savings will vary.
Yeah, I'm so stressed. Our business is growing. We've got people all over now.
Uma.
What is that? Meditation?
I'm recommending the Uma cloud phone system with auto attendant and more than 50 features.
Uma?
Yep, switching to Uma is a cinch. Just $24.95 per month per user, plus taxes and fees.
Uma.
Now you're feeling it. Find Small Business Calm at uma.com/radio. That's OOMA.com/radio.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Welcome back.
I can see you over there right now having hors d'oeuvres.
I thought you went to make plans already.
Let's see. Okay. This is my play-by-play call of the day.
Yeah.
Okay.
From ESPN.
So Destiny Harden, Miami beats the number one seed Indiana 7-68 in women's basketball.
Harden, step through. Oh, she gets it. No timeouts left for Indiana. 3.3 remaining. Moore McNeil with the ball. Takes it. Has it stolen away. Number one goes down. Miami pulls off the upset and knocks up Indiana on their home court.
Indiana?
Gone. Indiana no longer wants me.
No. Gone. All right. There you go. So John Griffin in. Hey, look. His dad was a really good coach in his time. And as I mentioned earlier, John himself... You know, I mentioned being down at St. Joe's. They stepped into a tough situation down there at St. Joe's. They did. Tough time, as I said earlier. And they brought it slowly back. I'm thrilled for him. Thrilled for Bucknell. That's good.
Some of his stats when he was a player, Steve, we talked about
1,084 points in a playing career for 4 years at Bucknell. As a senior, he was the first team All-Patriot League Honors Award winner. 13 points a game, ranks third on Bucknell's career three-point field goal list. That doesn't surprise me, with 220. And his 127 games played was the school record at that time.
Okay. Like I said, he will now go into a situation where instead of selling Bucknell, he will share Bucknell. And I think that's a cool thing to have in any program when you can have that.
Yeah, and as you mentioned, early in his career at Bucknell, he was one of the reserves on the Kansas and Arkansas games in the first round of 05 and 06. And, of course, the Kansas win was huge. Yeah. And he was part of that 05-06 squad that was that went 27-5, so he definitely knows how to win.
Yeah, no doubt. And look, he's worked his way to his, this point. You know, he grew up in a house. I mean, you know, his dad coached at St. Joe's and Siena and Roman and all sorts of places. And, you know, he was around it, and he played the game like a coach's son. And now he's going to get to coach the game like a coach's son.
Oh, and you were talking about their seed. They were a 9 seed that year.
See, I got it right.
I learned long ago. I do not doubt the sports encyclopedia that is in your head. That's a compliment. That is not a diss. That's a compliment.
It is a sad, pathetic world up there.
And we are working on getting when he finally gets squared away, he will be on the show.
Yeah, they'll be fine. We'll get him on. We'll talk to him. But I think I've always had a lot of respect for him as a player. I've heard nothing but good things about him as a coach, because obviously it's not like I don't know people at St. Joe's, because I do.
That's like saying Dick Girardi doesn't know anybody in Philly.
Oof. It's like we're over there. Colgate was practicing in the same high school we were. They just partitioned it off. And so also at Drake, too. It turned out their practice time was after Penn State's. So I got a chance to talk to Mac Langle a little bit. And, they've owned the Patriot now for years. After Bucknell owned the Patriot for years. So that'll be one of the first orders of business for John Griffin, is to get it back to that. So, congratulations. I give them credit. It's a terrific hire. Terrific hire. Bringing back one of their own. And not only that, I mean, you're talking about a guy that's in his 30s, got energy, he's got passion. Love it. Now we'll see what he can do with it. Be patient with him. Okay? Be patient with him. All right. Well, you know what? The next part for me is because of everything that happened with the NCAA tournament, guess what I haven't done this spring? Now, I went to four of the winter workouts, but I have not gone to a spring practice yet. Their fourth one's tonight. So I'll get to see them for the first time tonight for an extended period of time. Yeah.
That was a good trade-off, though. I'd take that trade-off.
I think the football people were thrilled by what the basketball guys did.
Is the blue-white game going to be the same setup as it has been in past years as far as how they're running it? Or haven't they announced yet?
I think James wants to go back to how it was. Last year, they had to do it the way they did because of the offensive line situation. It was stunning how many offensive linemen were not available last spring, to the point where they had to practice differently to work around it. When it came to the blue-white game last year, they had to work it around it there because they just didn't have enough, you know, they didn't have the numbers. Well, right now, they have the numbers, so I think they're going to, the idea is to have the blue-white game the way it has been in the past, not the way it's been the last couple of years.
So does that mean there's literally going to be two teams and they'll play it like a the football game? Mm-hmm. Or, is there a point system involved then?
No, I think it's going to play a game. I don't think it's going to be. I think they had the point system when Bill O'Brien was here.
You're right. I'm thinking back to that.
I mean, Jack and I would look at each other like, I don't even think I referenced the score. I think at the end I referenced the score.
Did.
I said, just for anybody who's like, okay, just in case. I said, now, how we got here, I don't know.
Well, I remember you and I went over it, and I'm like, wait a minute, how many points? He goes, and you're like, I don't know. I'm not worried about it. I'm not worried about it.
It was a little more about, like, performance.
Sure.
I was more about the performance part. Let's just do that.
Well, you know, you talk about the differences in spring practices. You know, Penn State has that ability, you know, most times to put out two full teams. Bucknell, because of the numbers that they have, which are quite different.
Yeah. Sure.
Several years ago, they had an offense and a defense, but the line, they had to move back and forth. Like, they actually had the same offensive line playing both offense and defense for both orange and blue that year. That was strange.
Yeah.
Because they had all the offensive linemen were in orange. And I think they did. I think that year all the offense was in offensive linemen were in orange. And then they had the blue and the white team, as I remember.
Mm-hmm.
But again, that's, you know, that shows the differences in the scholarships and the number of players and so forth.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's Bucknell's allowed to have 63 scholarships?
It's something like that. I can never remember. You could really see the difference when you watched Bucknell play Central Michigan. That was a great example. You know, they hung in that game for the first half.
Yeah, I watched that tape.
And they kind of ran out of gas because, you know, they just didn't have the numbers to be able to sub in the way Central Michigan was staying fresh.
Yeah. I watched some of that because they played them so well, and Penn State was playing them next anyway.
That was the next week,
So I was just trying to get a read on Central Michigan, and Bucknell's defense played really well in that game. You know, and I'm doing that from watching the tape, but yeah. All right, you were excited for Philly season, I'm sure.
Listen, if you're a Phillies fan and you're not excited about it, there's something wrong. I mean, this is the most anticipated season in maybe, you know, like 15 years.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, Steve, I'm now turned into one of those. I'm like, man, if this doesn't end up being a deep run into the playoffs like last year, it's going to be a letdown.
You got to stay injury free. Now you're going to start the year without Bryce Harper. I mean, so you've got to do that, and that's a big part of this. Can you somehow, some way, negotiate 6 months and have most of the team intact, especially at key spots, that allows you to then make that deep run? Now, Bryce Harper is not going to start the season on the 60-day IL. That's a good sign. That's a good sign because that gives them a little more leeway as to what's going on. And, you know, can they get enough pitching to make this happen?
That's the real question.
Can they get enough pitching? They've got enough offense. There's no doubt about that.
I can't stomach any more bullpen games. And I don't mean guys coming in from the bullpen. That's not what I'm talking about.
No, you're talking about.
I'm talking about the ones where, you know, this guy's only going to go two innings, then the next one's coming in for two innings, and the next one's coming in. Oh, I can't do that. That hurts. But they had to last year. I mean, they didn't have an option.
Everybody has to. Everybody has to.
But I don't ever remember hearing that before. Like, I've never, up until maybe, I don't know, 5 years ago, I've never heard of anybody talking about a bullpen game. You always had four guys and then a fifth one who was, like, okay and was able to get the job done for you. I mean, sometimes you had to go to the bullpen in the fifth inning because he really wasn't the starter. But now I'm hearing bullpen game, which means you're going to be there, you know, for two innings and you're done.
Well, it better be two good innings.
You're darn right.
By the way, you know what I find intriguing? I have only watched maybe part of an inning of the World Baseball Classic.
How about the same?
And it was in Shula's restaurant. And Dick and I went over to Shula's because it was the restaurant and the hotel. This was in Chicago. And on one of the many TVs, one of the games happened to be on. Okay. So I asked, it's a project-based class that I teach, and we're up to the project, and they've handed them in on talk shows. So they have to do a talk show as the latest project. 40% of the talk shows that they turned in were on the World Baseball Classic. Wow. And it's not as if there hadn't been great moments. Trey Turner with the Grand Slam. Last night's game with Japan was phenomenal. The Edwin Diaz injury, the Jose Altuve injury, the passion between Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic that's happened. I mean, these are all stories that I've read. And these young people were turning in one World Baseball Classic talk show after another. Well, that's a great sign for baseball. If young people, and the young people in my class are 20 to 22 years of age, young people are turning that in, that means they're watching it. And that's great. And I think what is the championship game is tonight?
Tonight, yeah. The U.S. and Japan tonight. And you know what? A couple of weeks ago, I was filling in and we talked about this. And you mentioned it and I mentioned it too. I mean, I never really thought it was a great idea in the spring. I thought it would be something better afterwards. And we got into that a little bit, and you made some great points in that. I've only watched a handful of parts of an inning here and there. But one thing I will say in watching some of the highlights of it, especially of the team from the United States, it is kind of like watching an all-star game with literally the best hitters you could possibly imagine, at least as far as the U.S. team was considered, U.S. teams considered. So I see the intrigue there. It's like, and it's an all-star game that means something too, not an all-star game that just happens mm-hmm. at the middle of the year because you want to see a whole bunch of guys play, whatever. This is a game that means something. So these guys are playing most of the game, if not all the game. And so I can see the intrigue there.
Well, I'll say this. If you're a team that has players in this, that means they're A, competitive ready, right? And it also means, for the most part, your pitchers that you're getting out of this are stretched out. So I think there are a lot of pluses out of this, despite the Diaz injury. The Diaz injury could happen anytime. You were jumping up and down in the middle of the diamond. I mean, it wasn't like, you know, the injury was caused by anything other than that. Altuve was diving back into first, I think. But
it also, on the other side, you get a good look at some guys that may not make the big league club when they're in their home clubs, and now they're getting a chance to really kind of show their stuff a little bit, and now you can see, okay, well, this guy may have some potential. I'll have to keep an eye on him at, in the Phillies' case, Lehigh Valley or Reading or wherever.
or Williamsport. No, I'm sorry. It should have been.
Don't think it's quite that far.
No. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Yeah, you've got Mookie Betts will lead off tonight. Mike Trout hits second. Paul Goldschmidt will hit third. Nolan Arenado cleanup. Kyle Schwarber will be the DH. Trey Turner's at short. JT Realmuto will be the catcher. So three Phillies right in a row. And then Cedric Mullins will be in left field tonight. And Timmy Anderson of the White Sox will be at second base. And Merrill Kelly will be on the mound tonight.
That's intriguing watching if you're a baseball fan. I'll be honest with you. I did not give the World Baseball Classic much interest, but I'll tell you what, I get it now.
Well, it's either that or watch the NIT quarterfinals tonight. You could do that. Wisconsin's playing at Oregon, and North Texas is at Oklahoma State.
And there's no new The Curse of Oak Island tonight, as far as I understand. So, you know, my night's free now. Should have cricket sound effects when this happens.
I seriously have no words.
It's a great show.
It's just, I've never seen it.
I have no doubt.
And there's nothing you can sell me on to make me see it.
I'm sure. Again, I have no doubt. I know you too well.
It's like, No.
Have you watched a Star Wars movie yet?
I saw the first one.
I meant besides the first one in the 70s. You know, they've had others.
Yeah, I didn't like it.
I know. That's why I brought it up.
I was like, eh, whatever. So I never watched any of the other ones.
That's exactly why I brought it up. Use the force, Steve.
It's like that time Daniel said to you, "You are my father." All right, so, and he was right. All right. We'll come back with more tomorrow.